tonight, the Philippine Senate taps the National Bureau of Investigation to search for a Farmily official who went off the radar after admitting her company may have swindled the government.
The Philippine Health Department downgrades the country's COVID classification from high to moderate.
Social Democrats in Germany beat the party of Chancellor Angela Merkel.
And a strong earthquake rocks Greece, killing at least one person and damaging many buildings.
Good evening. I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Karen Davila.
On our broadcast tonight, a missing witness and a detained resource speaker backing out of executive session. These are the latest wrinkles in the Philippine Senate's investigation of allegedly anomalous government purchases of COVID-19 medical supplies. Even so, senators believe they have enough proof to show government's deals with Farmily Pharmaceutical were indeed shady. Sherianne Torres has tonight's top story.
Senate Blue Ribbon Committee Chairman Richard Gordon has formally asked the National Bureau of Investigation's help in locating Farmily Pharmaceuticals Corporation Executive Grizel Grace Mago, who has been incommunicado to the Blue Ribbon panel since Sunday. During last Friday's committee hearing, Mago admitted that Farmily has swindled the government on its procured face masks, face shields, and other supplies, which some senators place at around 12 billion pesos. Also during the hearing, Mago promised to get back to the panel on its offered protective custody.
The Blue Ribbon has not been able to reach her. Nakabarin ako na baka masaktan yung bata. I have also enlisted the help of the Sisters of St. Paul's. I think I can say that. And they have been trying to reach her as well.
Gordon fears parties linked to the Farmily deal may hurt Mago. The last information he received, Mago being guarded in a house full of bodyguards. Senator Risa Ontiveros appeals to Mago to communicate to her office if she needs any form of assistance.
Patuloy yung aming pag-reach out sa kanya, pati sa pamamagitan ninyo sa media at sa social media, syempre.
Senator Panfilo Lacson says they also received information Farmily officials are actually receiving threats through text and phone calls since the upper chamber started its probe. Lacson remains hopeful Mago will still appear on Thursday. But Lacson believes Mago's absence, if ever, will not totally affect the proceedings given her previous statements made under oath.
So far naman kasi, nakapag-testify na siya at saka matibay naman yung kanyang testimonya.
On Monday, Farmily Executive Lin Con Ong has sent a handwritten note to the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee, turning down the panel's offer to hear his version of Farmily's dealings with the government through an executive session. Ong's newly hired counsel, Ferdinand Topacio, says his client never offered to appear before a closed session and accuses some senators of unfairly pinning down Ong to the point of already violating his rights. Topacio says they will decide if Ong should still participate at the Senate probe.
We are reconsidering that because this is not a fair forum. This is a kangaroo forum. The Blue Ribbon, not all, but some members of the Blue Ribbon Committee are not out to get the truth. They are out for blood.
Ong, who remains under the Senate custody, was supposed to be transferred to the Pasay City Jail. The move was deferred because of Ong's reported intention to appear in an executive session. Topacio says they will exhaust all legal actions to block any transfers.
Ang Senado is not above the law. It is not immune to legal processes. It is not immune to criminal cases.
But Senator Gordon is unfazed by Topacio's pronouncements.
Nanakot na sila, no? Sige, okay lang. Do your best, Ferdy. Yung mga talaga wala ibubugan, nananakot.
Senate President Vicente Soto III cautions Topacio against calling the Senate names or threatening the institution. The senators believe they already have strong evidence that would prove the government's transactions with Farmily were anomalous. The office of the president vows to look into Mago's allegations. But for the president's spokesperson, there's not much in Mago's testimonies.
Ang tanong po, tatayo ba ho yung ganyang testimonya? Tignan po natin. Kinakailangan po kasi yan, masubstantiate.
The Blue Ribbon Committee will hold its 10th hearing on the Farmily deal on Thursday. Sherianne Torres, ABS-CBN News.
Of Philippine House lawmaker denies lawyering for the Duterte administration despite seemingly downplaying a formerly official's allegation that the firm tampered with expiration dates of the face shields. Zandro Ochona reports.
The House Committee on Good Government and Public Accountability has decided to issue a subpoena for Crizel Mago, the head of regulatory affairs of Farmally Pharmaceutical Corporation. Lawmakers want to clarify issues after Mago's testimony before the Senate, where she said the government was swindled when her company tampered expired certificates of the procured face shields for medical frontliners. The committee chairman denied speculations. The House inquiry is one-sided and lawyering for the Duterte administration amid the parallel investigation in the Senate.
If we are one-sided, we will not anymore invite Ms. Mago. Hence, we will just leave her to be quiet in the darkness. But we want her here to know the whole truth.
The Health Department also clarified the shelf life for the purchased face shields.
Yung pinitisig ko, that's the styrofoam. That apparently is what is subject to the shelf life because pwede maging full bore.
36 months ba? Tama po ba? 36 months, hindi 6 months?
Hindi lang, 36 months po.
For the committee's vice chairperson, the issue is not on the expiry date, but if the medical supplies reach the frontliners.
Kung na-distribute po lahat yun, and then nagamit naman, eh, anong lugi ng gobernador? Meron bang hong nagreklamo na frontliner regarding the face shields that you distributed?
Mr. Chairman, wala pong nagreklamo, wala pong report of any complaints.
Deputy Speaker Rodante Marcoleta lectures the third-party accountant tapped by the Senate.
Nire-require ba ng bayanihan Juan na yung supplier bago siya makapag-supply, kinakailangan mataas ang kanyang capitalization o kaya kailangan i-prove niya sa'yo kung saan nang galing ang kanyang capitalization.
Mr. Chair, kasama po siya sa basic due diligence, Mr. Chair.
Hindi mo sinasagot ang tanong ko eh. Kung alam mo yung bayanihan Juan, dapat alam mo na walang nire-require doon kung anong minimum capitalization.
Marcoleta also lashed out at the Government Procurement Policy Board for muddling the essence of the Bayanihan Laws.
I am sorry to cut you. Ang sinasabi ko lang, bakit mo sinali pa ito? Kaya nagkakagulo eh. Bayanihan 1, categorically exempted or dispensed with the application of 9184, but you provided certain mechanism under 9184.
Yes po. It was a GP...
No. Teka muna. Mas marunong pa ba kayo sa Congress? Kami yung gumawa nito eh. Under Bayanihan 1, we disposed of the application of 9184.
A member of the Bacabayan Bloc reminded the committee why they were apprehensive in supporting Bayanihan 1 and 2.
Natatakot kami. Dahil tinatanggal natin o ini-exempt natin sa procurement law ang pagbili ng mahalagang aspeto despite the fact that there are already provisions within that law, especially sa ganitong panahon na kailangan ng mga negotiated bids, ay lalo pa natin nilawagan yung proseso.
The House Committee is set to send their counterpart in the Senate to request another formally executive Lincoln Ong to allow him to attend the next House inquiry via Zoom. Zandro Ochona, ABS-CBN News.
Better COVID numbers are being seen in Metro Manila and nearby regions, but health authorities remain guarded. Astro Val Busano tells us a point of concern is the decline in testing output nationwide.
From high risk, the country's risk classification in terms of cases has become moderate after recording a negative 4% growth rate in the last 2 weeks. Bed utilization has also become moderate risk for the entire country, but ICU utilization remains high. Average cases in the last 7 days decreased by a little over 2,000 compared to the previous week. The health department says improvements were seen in the capital region after posting a negative 13% growth rate. In the meantime, regions 4A and 3, which are close to the NCR, are now considered moderate risk. But the DOH Epidemiology Bureau is still being cautious despite improving COVID data.
Tayo po ay nagtatriangulate at meron tayong iba't ibang metrics na tinitingnan para po buo yung picture na maibibigay namin sa inyo. We need to assess the large decline.
One thing that's giving them pause is the decline of testing output from laboratories. Data show testing has decreased by 10%. And the DOH wants to know what's happening.
Despite the active case finding, talaga po bang wala na pong dagdag or kaunti na lamang ang mga kasong nahahanap natin? Ikalawa rin pong pinag-aaralan natin ay yung pag-shift, no, or paggamit po ng antigen test aside from the RT-PCR.
But for Professor Jomar Gabahante of the UP COVID-19 Pandemic Response Team, while overall cases see an improvement, many regions are not experiencing it.
There are regions na nag-i-increase. For example, sa CAR, sa Baguio, nagkaroon tayo ng spike. Sa Region 5, sa Davao Region, sa Region 4B, may mga ganito po tayong nakikitang mga spikes na kung titingnan natin, ay importanteng mabigyan ng pansin.
Professor Gabahante notes vaccines may have contributed to better COVID numbers, especially in areas where coverage is high.
Lalo na sa NCR, kitang-kita yung effect ng mataas na percentage ng tao na nabakunahan.
The government is working on further ramping up vaccinations now that more jabs have arrived. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Filipino healthcare workers express outrage at a proposal that seeks to consolidate their monetary benefits. Zen Hernandez reports.
They're wearing the
A group of nurses says only 27.5% of the 1.8 million healthcare workers in the country have been able to receive their special risk allowance so far. This does not include other COVID-19 benefits, such as the active hazard duty pay, as well as the meals, accommodation and transportation, or MAT allowance, all stipulated under the Bayanihan 2 law, which lapsed in June. But due to issues with implementation, the Department of Health is now proposing a singular allowance. Under the said proposal, payment will be based on risk exposure. 3,000 pesos for those with low exposure or assigned to areas without patients. 6,000 pesos for those with medium exposure or handling non-COVID-19 patients. And 9,000 pesos for those with high exposure or directly catering to COVID-19 patients. The DOH estimates it will need 50.4 billion pesos. To pay 526,727 health workers. But health workers question this figure.
Ang bilang na yan ay kumakatawan lamang sa 29% ng 1.8 million health workers. Kaya po talagang it's a heartless, walang puso at mapanghati yung proposal ng DOH na singular allowance. Ibigay muna po nila yung mga utang sa amin.
The DOH already confirmed before the Senate Committee on Finance that the total number of health workers are around this number, but only 500,000 are considered COVID-19 frontline workers. The Alliance of Health Workers says this is unfair to other workers.
Bate sa actual na karanasan, maraming health workers na hindi nasayan sa COVID areas ang nahawa at patuloy na nahahawa sa COVID-19 dahil mas less protected sila. Kung kaya't lahat ng mga nasa vicinity at loob ng ospital at health facility ay maituturing na nasa high risk.
Health workers also feel they are being shortchanged since if all COVID-19 benefits will be given in full, they would have gotten 5,000 pesos in SRA monthly, 3,000 in hazard pay, and 8,000 pesos for the MAT allowance. The continued non-payment of COVID-19 benefits has caused further demoralization among health workers, forcing many of them to quit. This is causing serious understaffing in public hospitals and even in the private sector. A group of private hospitals previously said they are still unable to replace the 40% of manpower they lost to resignations since the start of the pandemic.
hanggat hindi dinideklara ng gobyerno na taasan ang sahod ng mga nurses at allied healthcare workers, malabo po yun. Base doon sa datos ng union namin, ay ngayong matatapos ang buwan, meron na namang panibagong mga 18 na magsasubmit ng resignation.
Health workers urged the government to prioritize the health sector, starting with paying their COVID-19 benefits, increasing salaries to prevent health workers from quitting or leaving, as well as attracting new hires and giving them security in their jobs, since the health department's own records show they have more than 25,000 health workers on job order or contractual arrangements. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
At least 600 national and local candidates of Aksyon Demokratiko will be fielded for next year's Philippine polls. Aksyon Chairman Ernest Ramel Jr. says the party's membership recently grew by 300%. Recent additions to their party include former Lakas CMD official Dr. Willie Ong, the running mate of Aksyon presidential bet Manila Mayor Isko Moreno. Another new member is Caloocan Representative Edgar Erice, who jumped ship from the Liberal Party. Former Ocho Diretso senatorial candidate Samira Gutok and radio show host Carl Balita have confirmed they are now part of Aksyon Demokratiko's 2022 senatorial slate.
The Philippine government's anti-communist task force is voicing stiff opposition to House Bill 1171, or the Act of Institutionalizing the 1989 UPE-DND Accord. The accord establishes rules on military and police operations inside the campuses of the University of the Philippines. The bill, approved on third and final reading today, prohibits state forces from entering any UP campus without prior notice and subjecting students and staff without informing administrators. The anti-communist task force argues the bill will only provide safe haven to lawbreakers and terrorist groups. In January, Defense Secretary Delfin Lorenzana suddenly ended the agreement, saying there is a need to prevent the university from becoming a breeding ground for communists.
Coming up next, German Chancellor Angela Merkel on her way out.
Also later, British authorities rush to address a looming fuel shortage. The World Tonight returns after the break.
Back on the World Tonight, it's the end of an era in Germany where the Social Democrats have defeated the party of Chancellor Angela Merkel in recently concluded parliamentary elections. Here's the full story.
Germany's Social Democrats narrowly won a milestone election on Sunday, a victory that marks an end to 16 years of conservative rule under Angela Merkel. Projected results showed the center-left Social Democrats were on track for 26% of the vote, ahead of nearly 25% for the conservative bloc, though both groups believe they could lead the next government. SPD's candidate for Chancellor, Olaf Scholz, thanked his supporters.
And of course, I'm very happy about the election result that the citizens of this country have chosen. They have decided that the SPD should rise upwards, and that is a big success.
Scholz would become the fourth socialist Democrat chancellor since World War II. His conservative rival, Armin Laschet, signaled his bloc was not ready to concede, though his supporters were more subdued.
We will do everything possible to build a conservative-led government because Germany
Deutschland
Germany now needs a future coalition that modernizes our country.
The most likely outcome is a three-way alliance involving the smaller Greens and Liberal Free Democrats, led by either the Social Democrats or Merkel's conservatives. A new coalition could take months, and Merkel will remain in charge in a caretaker role while Scholz and Laschet court the support of the smaller parties. They have both said they aim to form a coalition before Christmas.
The British government will offer temporary visas to more than 10,000 drivers. The move aims to address a supply chain crisis that's affecting the country's fuel supply. Some gas stations have resorted to fuel rationing. The pandemic and the UK's exit from the European Union prompted thousands of EU nationals to leave their trucking jobs in the UK.
A magnitude 5.8 quake rocks Greece's largest island, Crete, on Monday. One person was killed when the dome of a church collapsed. Authorities say at least 9 other people were injured. Many buildings were also damaged.
The PSE index ekes out gains even as foreign investors dump local stocks. Michelle Ong reports.
Asian markets traded cautiously on Monday as oil jumped to 3-year highs, threatening to stoke inflation further and aggravate what's already a hawkish tone from major central banks. Here at home, Philippine shares were steady, gaining less than 0.1% to close at 69.56, with foreign funds turning net sellers yet again. Manulife Investment Management's Mark Canizares recalls it was also mid-October last year when local shares rallied on positive COVID-19 news flow and the traditional holiday spending.
Well, for the full year, remember, the market is looking at an earnings or an EPS growth of around 13 to 15% for 2021. There were some downgrades along the way, remember, because we went into lockdown around April and then you've had that unexpected lockdown in August again. We're expecting that actually in 2022, EPS growth will resume further to a level that's higher than 15%, maybe closer to 20%. And I think one thing that we'd like to point out is that if you look at return on equity of the market, it's now closer to 7 to 9%. That is also expected to move back to a double-digit range, probably closer to 2022, 2023.
In corporate stories, Aboitiz Equity Ventures is selling 25% of its power subsidiary to Japan's largest power generator, JERA Company, for $1.5 billion, a move that's seen to unlock significant capital that can be used to fuel the group's growth initiatives. The group says it stands to benefit from the experience and expertise of JERA with potential collaboration in LNG-to-power projects and new technologies. AEV shares are up 2.1%, while Aboitiz Power shares jumped nearly 5%. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Susie Kasem. Stand up for the truth, even if it means standing alone.
And that is The World Tonight, the 27th of September, 2021. I'm Karen Davila.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay.